Hello there. This is winding yarn onto in-fed bobbins, also sometimes called perns. My bobbin winder came with my Laguerre machine, but no bobbins. Instead of trying to track those down, I made me an adapter to go on that I could use half-inch PVC pipe and made some round ends, bases out of masonite. And I'll start winding on here. If you have an original bobbin, you may want to start at the base. There's sometimes an undercut area here, but that first few loops you'll want to get pretty tight on there. You don't want this thing loose, because your whole, once you get it wound, your whole yarn could end up sliding up, and that could be a disaster. You don't want that to happen. So first I'll create some mass down here and get this built up in a short place. On the end of the cone, the back end down here, we'll work it up until we get the diameter, the full diameter that we want to go the rest of the way up on the cone. I've got a fair amount of tension here on this, not enough that my yarn is trying to cut down into the yarn itself, and I'll get to more about that in a second, but enough that it is fairly firm. Okay. I'm getting up pretty close to where I want this diameter out here, and I'm going to start, I call it scatter winding, where I'm not going to have real nice, neat little turns where everyone's right beside each other. I want it to be scattered. And what that will do is it will prevent any place my yarn can't cut down into itself, because there's a crisscross pattern going on here. So at any particular place, it's not going to cut down in. What happens and can happen, if it does, if you wind it neatly, very neatly, side by side, each row side by side, is that it will cut in at some place, and then as you're weaving, or excuse me, as you're pulling off the end, it will end up pulling several layers off the end, and then you have a real mess. So as you can see from that chart, our diameter that we build up going down through here will be from the layers that are come on in the comb shape, go across. So I'll continue to wind here, build up, get up to that point. And now I'm going to start winding where I don't go all the way back to the base. I'm going to be a little shy of it, in theory anyway. And also, as I wind on, this curve starts to come in here, and I guess that's a parabolic, possibly a Canterbury curve. And I'll just do a few passes in here to kind of build that back up. See on the left here that is starting to form a full diameter. So the layers that we are building on are actually layers that are cutting at this angle, and down the end of where we're coming back and forth is what is forming this diameter. Another thing that doing these long scattered passes serves, and I'll cover that more towards the end of the video, is that Forever Revolution you've got on here, when that comes off, that adds one twist to the yarn by having a long wind on like this. We have several inches of yarn that's gone on, but only one revolution on the spindle. So it reduces the number of turns and twists that that's going to put on when we feed this off of the end. Well, I'm about finished up here, and as you can see, the diameter is formed here, but this is, each one of these rounds is the end of this cone-shaped round. I did run into one knot while I was winding, which is one of the big reasons for rewinding a yarn package, of course, so that you end up with something you're not expecting. And I have ran into a few times lately where there was no knot at all. It just simply wasn't connected. And especially with cranking socks, if you're not expecting that, you can crank right through it and drop your work, whatever you got done. I wanted to touch on the direction that the yarn feeds off the end of the bobbin. It does affect the yarn, and I specifically wind my yarn with the winder here in my left hand so that when I'm winding it goes, it's going over the top, so when it unwinds, it unwinds in a clockwise direction. And most of the yarn I have, or maybe all the yarn that I looked at that I have around here, has an S twist to it. And here's a picture of Z and S twist. With S twist yarn, when it comes off the end of the spindle clockwise, it adds to the twist of the yarn. Each revolution adds one twist. And this yarn in particular, it can have a tendency to be a little bit loose in places. If I'd wound that on in the other direction, each round would subtract, or actually loosen up a little more, your yarn. And you can end up some places, if you untwist enough, to where your yarn is going to be weak. It's not going to be have the twist that it needs for the strength. So this is something to be aware of when you're winding the yarn on. If you set your winder to the other side and wind with your right hand, just be aware of what direction you're going to pull the yarn off of. If you have yarn that you've maybe frogged your sock two or three times, it may be starting to get quite a bit of a heavy twist in it, more than you need. And that would be a time then that by knowing this information, you could wind it on in the other direction and actually decrease the twist in it a little bit. Okay, everybody put on your BGPs. We're going to have a graphic demo. This will kind of illustrate the twist that goes into the yarn when you pull it off the end of a spindle. You can see each revolution around adds one more twist to the fiber. If you flip it over and pull off the other end, we'll be pulling off counterclockwise, and although it's not going to pick it up on camera, it'll actually end up taking the twist back out of that, but that's not what we're looking for. I just want to demonstrate, and if you're aware of how it reacts, how the things work together, you can compensate for it or use it to your advantage when you're winding your yarn onto the bobbin.